You can fit so much spaghetti in this bad boy. Got a desk. All right, let's go.
We are outside of the voting office. And I just casted my ballot.
That clip you just saw was me turning in my absentee ballot in Montana for early voting. And I'm a little bit late to the party for this video today, so to get you caught up with everything happening in the news, this is going to be a longer video than usual. But I promise it will be worth it. First, I'm going to go over some tame news from the past week, and then at the 5-minute mark, I become unhinged. So, first off, check out this video of a millennial college professor.
This cannot be looked down on.
Cause tonight will be the night that I will fall for you again. Don't really change my mind.
Structure and syntax are, of course, very important when making a compelling argument.
Do you have that time to listen to me whine about nothing and everything all at once?
So when you're writing an essay, don't forget to... Introduction is a robust predictor of reading comprehension at all levels, including primary education.
Don't waste your time on me, you're already the voice inside my head.
This guy uses emo lyrics to wake up sleeping students. Honestly, as a 1989 kid myself, I absolutely love seeing this. Airlines now have to give refunds when they cancel your flight. Honestly, this one was a long time coming, and I think everyone can agree.
Well, I've just got to say, we're news people, even though we're at the opinion section. It's got to be reported. Bucks County was reversed by the court and instructed to open up extra days because they violated the law and told people to go home. So that lawsuit was brought by the Republican National Committee, and it was successful. The Supreme Court ruled that Glenn Youngkin was successful. We are news people, even though we have opinions, and we have to report the whole story if we bring up part of the story. So yes, he's upset about Bucks County, but he was right and he won in court. That's the story.
I'll let you keep going, Jonathan.
No, I'm just, I don't appreciate being lectured about reporting when you, many times you come here saying lots of things that aren't
based in fact. I won't come back, Jonathan. I'm done. This is the most unfair election ad I have ever been a part of. You guys are working. That's fine. I'm done.
So, Ruth, you wrote a column this week ending with this line, and actually, I think this is perfect. We're going to put it on the screen. You wrote, "You want to know the stakes of this election? Not only democracy, but decency." Talk more about that, Ruth.
Okay, I'm collecting myself.
Oh, Ruth froze. Ruth is frozen. So hang in there, everyone. We're going to see if we can try to get Ruth back to this very... We're going to get Ruth back in a moment. This is First Look, Washington Post Live's nonstop shop for news and analysis, and Ruth is back. So I'm going to read that quote back again from your column, Ruth, where you wrote, "You want to know the stakes of this election? Not only democracy, but decency." We lost her again. Everybody, if you've been watching First Look, you know that these conversations can be interesting, contentious. You just saw Hugh Hewitt leave the conversation, which is lamentable, unfortunate. It is what it is. I am Jonathan Caper. I want to thank you all very much for joining us on First Look for more of these important conversations.
And now I become unhinged. Salutations, Curse Nation. My name is Wolf, and you're watching my new show, Curse Context, on the Wolf Channel, spelled VVVLF. We have a lot of stuff to cover today. I've been stacking clips all week and working on this episode. The project was 3 hours long before I whittled it down. Get ready, the conspiracy rabbit hole will come at the end. So first off, check out this next video of Howard Lutnick on how the Biden administration lost $80 billion of weapons in Afghanistan, essentially arming them with everything that Iran could ever hope to buy from them to fight us.
Unbelievable that she gets on television and calls him a fascist. He already was the president. We had, before COVID, we had 3% growth, 3% wage growth and GDP growth, inflation below 2%. He wasn't a fascist. He hired the wrong people. We agree. And now he has disgruntled former employees, right? All these people got fired. Who got fired in the Biden administration? You want to have a fun thought? Did we, when we pulled out of Afghanistan, was it really stupid and a mistake? Like, we left $80 billion worth of stuff behind. Was it a mistake? It wasn't. If you think about it, if I get you to quickly move out of your house and leave everything behind, when you get to your new house, what's the first thing you have to buy? A whole bunch of new furniture. So if I leave $80 billion worth of equipment behind, what's the first thing the military industrial complex is going to do? Buy more stuff. So who hates Donald Trump and hates war? Dick Cheney. Of course, Dick Cheney. What's Dick Cheney's legacy? Let's go take out Iraq, which Donald Trump says is the dumbest thing that's ever happened in recent military exercise. Why? Iraq and Iran, they kill each other for what? Thousands of years? We take out Iraq and we free Iran to try to take on the West.
He explains how they got rid of $80 billion in weapons, as in $80 billion with a capital B, to Afghanistan because the military-industrial complex would have to be paid to replace them. And who profits? What party is in power? What's the Pelosi stock portfolio have in it? This one is relevant to my last video. In the next clip, RFK Jr. speaks at a Turning Point event about how the Biden administration just signed into law for the DOD the authority to use lethal force against American citizens. To learn more about this, watch my previous video, She Loved Killing Them Babies. I'll link that in the description below. Here's the clip of RFK.
President Harris said today in her post, in her speech, she said that President Trump was going to turn the U.S. military against the American public and use the public to promote his agenda. How many of you think that is true? Well, what's interesting to me is that the Biden-Harris administration has done something 2 weeks ago that has never been done in American history, which is to send exactly lethal force, to send a directive to the Pentagon, changing the law to make it legal for the U.S. military to be used to use lethal force against American citizens on American soil. And technically, now it's legal, the U.S. military, under this directive, it will become legal for the U.S. military to shoot and kill Americans who engage in political protests because they disagree with policies in the White House. I'm not making this up. Any of you can look it up. This is a Democratic initiative. This did not come during the Trump administration. This did not come from Donald Trump.
Now check out this next clip of Kami Allah getting straight up torched on CNN by Anderson Cooper.
Saying, well, what you're saying is anyone under 400,000 won't have taxes raised. Are you saying that anyone above 400,000 will have a tax raise?
I'm saying that there is going to be...
She doesn't know, does she?
A parity around what the richest people pay in terms of their taxes.
Huh?
The document, it is well documented that some of the richest people in our country have gotten away with a zero tax rate.
I don't think your math is right.
If you're earning $500,000, $600,000, $700,000 under your plan, there's a good chance your taxes go.
We can't have this conversation with...
She has no idea.
Yeah, I didn't just stutter, I actually said that. The left is officially eating itself right now. This is fucking insane. Oh, and speaking of the tolerant left, is this your definition of tolerance?
Hey!
What, you worried I'm gonna stain your fucking signs that are telling lies to people?
Aw, oh, I'm so sorry.
God!
Kids still can't change their gender.
We fucking tried to talk to you, asshole.
I just tried to talk to you.
But most of
them. Alright, then.
I think we're good. Just we try to keep it.
If you enjoy getting this stain out,
hey, dude, don't get it on our stuff. Hi.
Hello. Can you please not do that?
Why?
Because this is our stuff.
Can you please not do this?
We were allowed to table here. We actually have a permit.
Yeah?
Yeah, we do.
I'm not touching you. I'm grabbing your phone.
Well, that's yeah, you can't touch his phone.
I'm not touching your phone. I'm covering the camera.
Okay.
You're not touching it.
Why are you here?
Because we have a right to be here. Why are you here?
Because I have a right to be here.
We care about kids. We care
okay,
about
so why are you damaging our stuff?
Behold the tolerant left.
And check out this video where some young girl, honestly, I don't blame them for being ignorant, can't back their shit up to an actually informed individual who's dressed like the Dark Knight Joker. And then they leave the chat. This actually happened to me earlier today with my brother's friend.
Camilla, because it's gonna be the first woman president.
So you're voting for her not on her policies, not because of anything she said is going to benefit the country. You're voting for her solely on the purpose of her being a woman.
No, she is better for the country.
How?
She's gonna lower prices.
How is she going to do that?
She's going to lower grocery prices. She's the president. She's
right.
Going to lower...
But she's been in power for the last 4 years. Why hasn't she done it already? She's in power. She's in power right now. So why exactly are we still paying over $3 for gas, $10 for bacon, $13 to $14 for egg? The grocery prices are out of control. And if she's going to lower prices, why doesn't she do it now?
This next one is wild. I've met countless people who think it's so hard to illegally enter the country. Like, basically insinuating me that we should cut the immigrants some slack, not understanding illegal migrants now account for more than 1 in 10 of every Americans, and not realizing that it literally takes them less than 5 minutes on a government app to enter the country, created by the Biden-Harris administration. The app is called the CBP1 app, and it will provide you a place to be picked up by Border Patrol and transported into the U.S. to a center where you're given a court date 7 years from that day. And it grants you temporary asylum. And it takes less than 5 minutes. And it's worse than just what I'm describing to you. So here, let's let this dude explain it better. This is fucked. We are being invaded, and if you don't think so, you're ignorant to the truth or maliciously lying.
Watching that vice presidential debate last night, I was curious just how easy that CBP1 app was to use. So I downloaded it.
So once you create an account from the main page, you just have to choose if you're the smuggler or the smugglee. Then you just got to fill in basic info, first name, last name, you know, all the basics. I don't know my gender yet. I'm still figuring that out. Now it's time to take a selfie. And a passport or any identification is also optional.
Then it asks you which state you're headed to. I said I didn't know the address, I didn't know the city. I just chose California, and then I added the first zip code that Google gave me for California. And that's it, I'm good to go. It does let you choose between like 8 different bridges to meet under. I chose the Eagle Pass Bridge to meet under. I just have to wait until noon, so a couple more hours, to actually make my appointment.
Now I know what you're saying. That's not you, that's Carlos Mencia. Correct. I was just trying to show you how easy it was to register. I'm just a white dude from Michigan. This took me 5 minutes. Someone who really wants to get into this country, get temporary asylum with open-ended expiration dates, they'll just use their own picture. I said, I have no documentation, I have no ID, no passport, no license. There is no way to cross-check who I say I am with who I really am. All they go off of is the picture that you see.
And Mel Gibson said Kamala is dumber than a fence post to paparazzi this week.
Being voted on in days. What's your thoughts?
Oh, man, that's a big question.
What's up?
I don't think it's going to surprise anyone who I vote for.
Well, so, I mean, I'm going to guess.
Yeah.
I'm going to guess
Trump.
Is that a bad guess?
I think it's a pretty good guess.
Well, what do you think the world will be like in a second term? With President Trump second term.
I know what it'll be like if we let her in.
Yeah. Oh, really?
And that ain't good.
Yeah.
Well, miserable track record. Appalling track record. No policies to speak of.
Yeah. And the border, right?
And she's got the IQ of a fence post.
If you watched my previous video, you saw the whole "you're at the wrong rally" incident where Kamala attacked Christians. Well, they're fighting back with memes now. Actually, everyone is fighting back with memes now. Here's a "Who Wants to Be a Millionaire" joke about how she can't answer questions. And here's some random YouTube comments as evidence of how the public zeitgeist has completely turned on her. In this next clip, Rogan addresses why the public turned against Donald Trump.
Trump's going to go to war with us. He was with Bush when they went stupidly into the Middle East. They should have never done it. I used to say it as a civilian. So I always got more publicity than other people. And it wasn't like I was trying. In fact, I don't know exactly why. Maybe you can tell me why.
Oh, I could definitely tell you. You said a lot of wild shit. CNN, in all their brilliance, by highlighting your wild shit, made you much more popular.
Yeah.
And they boosted you in the polls because people were tired of someone talking in this bullshit, pre-prepared politician lingo. And even if they didn't agree with you, they at least knew whoever that guy is, that's him. That's really him. When you see certain people talk, certain people in the public eye, you don't know who they are. You have no idea who they are. It's very difficult to know. You see them in conversations. They have these pre-planned answers. They say everything. It's very rehearsed. You never get to the meat of it. One of the beautiful things about you is that you freeball. Like, you get out and you do these huge events, and you're just talking. And you're making... We've highlighted you on the show many times when you did this Biden impression where he's walking around, he doesn't know what he's doing. It's funny. It's stand-up. It's funny stuff. But it's like... You were making fun of Elon one time. You were doing an Elon impression. It's great. You have like comedic instincts. Like when you said to Hillary, you'd be in jail. Like that's great timing.
Yeah.
But it's like that kind of stuff was unheard of as a politician. Like no one had done that. And I think...
You know, it's funny. You need at least the attitude of a comedian when you're doing this business. This is a very dangerous business, first of all. It's a very tough business.
It's the most dangerous business.
Yes, the most. Well, for a job?
Yes. Other than going to war and being a firefighter or being a cop, it's the most dangerous business.
It's the most dangerous. Being president is the most dangerous.
Especially you. I mean, haven't even got to the election. There's been two assassination attempts. And they've brushed those out of the news like it was nothing.
Yeah, they'd rather not talk about them.
Imagine if there was assassination attempts on Biden, how hard people would be attacking the right. How they would be trying to get guns taken away from people. They would try to ramp up gun laws. They would try to figure out some way to blame you. If there was attacks on... If Biden got shot in the ear, we would have never heard the end of it.
But I think he's in good shape.
Maybe Kamala can learn from this one. Oh, and for all you idiots who say, "I dare them maggots to start a civil war." First off, you fail to realize it's going to be the radical left who cast the first stone. And no one is going to be backed by the US military. A real civil war would be a us versus them scenario, because in case you forgot, it's illegal to fight the government. And here's what US air support looks like. More about how you think you're ready for a civil war, and then come back to me with your plan to hide. That last one was kind of dark, so send this to bro to cheer him back up.
Bro, I sent you this video because big things coming, bro. Big things coming, bro. We're on the up. Stay focused, stay driven, because big things coming. Send this to bro for 700 years of good luck. Let's get it, bro. We on the up. We on the up. No one gets how hard we've been working, bro. Failure isn't an option for us, bro. Let's get it, bro. Lock in. Big money, big up. Big things are coming, and they're coming fast. Big things coming, bro. Oh, there it is. Money. We on the up, bro. People don't even know how locked in we've been.
While Trump was doing a rally, he made a comment about what Kamala was doing.
The Middle East, it's like a tinderbox. It's ready to explode. People are being killed at levels that we've never seen before. And that's taking place right now in Michigan. She is in literally a free fall. They've had it with her. Nobody's in charge. Joe Biden is asleep. Kamala is at a dance party with Beyonce.
And in case you are still trying to dispute my claim that the radical left is the most violent political faction, here's a radical leftist screaming in the face of a Trump supporter's infant. And in this next clip, these literal children take their school board administration back to class and get standing ovations. I'll let the kids do the talking on this one.
Despite the board's attempt to deny it, District 196 schools are quickly becoming a place where promoting activism is actually more important than promoting education. I'll take you back to my first day at RHS this fall. The principal came out and gave us a heartfelt speech about equality and standing together. He began to list countless races, such as Latino, Asian, expressing how much they matter and how important they are. But never once did he mention a race or identity that reflects me, or half the kids that were in the class. Now, members of the board, I know you haven't been to school in a while, and I know most of you don't have any kids left in the school district. But you must admit how uncomfortable it will be to be characterized just by your skin color on the first day of school, and be thought that you were wrong just because of your skin color. So I'll never forget the look one of my friends gave me from across the room as we were sitting there listening to this blatant bias being expressed in the so-called equity statement by the leader of our school. To be clear, I don't need you to tell me that I matter, but hearing the condolences given to other races and leaving just one race out, it inevitably you'll start to feel like you've done something wrong. And in our principal's attempt to unify us, he instead created unwarranted boundaries and barriers between his students, pitting us against each other based on characteristics that we can't control. In another separate instance, I was told that writing "All Lives Matter" on the whiteboard was political and could be seen as offensive. When I questioned the teacher after class, she told me that she didn't have an answer and she just had to erase it, and it was quickly erased. There are political signs all over RHS, about specific races that matter, specific sexual orientations that matter, and specific perspectives that matter. But when I questioned the RHS administration about how these signs were political, they told me that they were supporting human rights. So when I questioned why the equity statement couldn't represent all students, they told me that to even ask that question was outlandish and offensive. And when I asked why that was, they told me, quote, "whites have a pretty good situation right now," unquote. So is that not racism? Disregarding my question merely because of the color of my skin. To be honest, after enduring a year of the people in charge telling me that I'm a racist and I'm privileged and pointing out our irreversible differences, I've never noticed race more. And it's becoming the first thing I notice when I meet someone, which has never before been the case. RHS administration confidently told me that RHS students and staff are happy with their equity statement. But from my experience in talking with other students, this is not the case. I know many kids who disagree with their teachers, but they're too scared to stand up because they're worried that their grades will be docked and their learning experience will be affected. My honors government teacher, I'm not going to say his name, but he's mentioned that Democrats care more about all people while Republicans only care about themselves. And he's also inferred to us that socialism is better than democracy. He even had a statue of a socialist leader in his classroom. I've been told by a lot of kids that they just stay silent and adjust their schoolwork to reflect an acceptable opinion to secure a good grade. I've been approached by multiple teachers who have told me in private that they just want to say that they agree with me and they support me standing up, but they can't say it in front of the class for fear of being disciplined by the administration in some way or losing their jobs. There is clearly only one way to think in this district, and that is that they are teaching their kids to shut up if they don't agree. Now, members of the board, I want you to take a good look at yourselves in the mirror tonight and ask, are you really standing up for the equality of all people, or are you just pushing a damaging political ideology on our students? A fellow coworker at my job, who, by the way, is of color, discreetly told me that the schools seem to be pushing a very leftist agenda in class. This proved that not everyone is happy with your school, and not everyone who isn't happy is white. Now, due to all these instances I've mentioned and many more that I can't fit in this 5-minute speech, I have decided to leave this district and continue school on a private Christian school online. And there will be sacrifices, and I will not get to walk in the graduation ceremony or attend milestones at RHS, but I will be able to learn in an environment that is not intent on punishing me daily for my skin color and political views. Now, regardless of how you take my speech, whether you just shrug it off as malarkey or Fox News talking points, I encourage you to think about it, because someday I'm going to be a leader. I may be the president, a governor, or just a professional golfer, but I will never stop believing that everybody has value, no matter their skin color or personal beliefs, and it's a shame that you're not going to be able to say that I was an alumni of RHS in District 196. Thank you.
No, we're here to listen to you. We'll be
no, you asked that we abide by your rules and set our literature here for Mr. Brodsky to pass out. And if you're not going to abide by your own rules,
then you got to put it in the minutes too, just so everybody knows. Put it in the minutes.
If you're not going to abide by your own rules,
put it in the minutes.
If you're not going to abide by your own rules, I will take those back and I will pass those out myself to all of you. So it's either
you want
one
to start
or the other.
I'm sorry, you cannot
really
read your own rules
out.
It's under the rubber rules of
order. You just said it.
Pass them out.
At the
beginning. Pass them out.
Oh, you're just said
it.
You just said it.
I don't think we should be reading it right now.
You were reading
them. Put it in the minutes, too.
Oh, we should.
My camera's on, so I don't need
yours. Reclaim her minutes.
Reclaim her minutes.
She hasn't started yet.
Not started yet. I reclaim my time. It is my First Amendment right. You reset that timer.
Yeah.
No.
Yes.
Reset her time.
Reset her time.
Reset her time.
Reset the time.
Reset the time.
Reset the time.
Gentlemen, reset the time.
What's wrong with you people?
Reset the time.
There's
a young lady coming here.
Three.
Three.
Reset my time.
Everybody stop. Don't come at me. Don't come at me. Because you're out of order.
Reset her time.
Snowflakes.
At the last meeting, I sat in astonishment as Superintendent Roberts tried to gaslight us regarding public comments at these meetings. He told us how important it was that everyone speaking felt listened to by this board, regardless if the board hears things they disagree with. All the hypocrisy, especially after most of this board walked out while I was addressing you at the August meeting. Then, this board's lawyer, Mr. Collins, tried to set rules regarding the content of people's speeches, but also claimed the idea wasn't to censor people. Newsflash, Mr. Collins. Your rules are the very definition of censorship. Apparently, this board is not familiar with the U.S. Constitution, so I've given each of you a copy. Please note the First Amendment on page 21, which clearly states there shall be no rules abridging freedom of speech. Additionally, the people have the right to air grievances to the government. So, to clarify this to you, board members, a board of education is the governing body of a school district, and therefore, we have the constitutional right to speak about whatever grievances we have. You can't limit the content or direct who we can or cannot talk about. If you don't want to be embarrassed or be in the spotlight, then resign from this board.
Yeah.
If you don't want your family members to be a topic, then they should refrain from making statements on social media in regards to people who speak at these meetings. If you don't want people to refer to you as groomers and pedophiles, then follow state and federal laws and remove the sexually graphic books from your school libraries. Amen. Appeasing immorality by claiming acceptance and inclusion is not a valid argument. Claiming the books can be obtained online, no, it is my First Amendment right, and you have taken my time, so I reclaim that time back. Let me see. I am going to continue. Not invalid argument. Claiming that removing the contested books is banning them is not a valid argument. There are no valid arguments for violating laws or infringing on constitutional rights. A quote by Wendy Jane states, "An environment that is not safe to disagree in is not..."
And like I keep saying, the public has spoken. Watch as Kamala gets booed into silence at a rally last week.
We are fighting for America's future. And we understand the opportunity we have before us to turn the page on the fear.
You guys, this is historic. Tell me the last time you remember an American sitting vice president getting silenced at their own rally. I've never seen this before. This Instagram reel is fucking wild. General John Kelly says Trump is a Nazi, but he sits on the board of DC Capital Partners, the company that operates the biggest shelter for migrant unaccompanied children. The Democrats are invested in profiting off of the migrants, and it's why they accuse Trump of being a Nazi, because they, the Democrats, are the Nazis.
So check this out. So General John Kelly, who suddenly tells us that Trump admires Hitler, Trump admires Hitler's generals, Trump says Hitler did some good things, according to General John Kelly in The Atlantic. Is the general telling the truth, or could there be something else motivating these comments? Well, it turns out, and you just do a little bit of digging, General John Kelly sits on the board of the company that operates the biggest migrant shelter for unaccompanied children who are coming over the border without parents or guardians. That company is called DC Capital Partners, and they own two other companies called Acuity International, and the other one's called Valiance Humanitarian. Yes, and you know what they get? Massive contracts, no bid, meaning they don't have to bid against other companies, from the government. So now, if Trump is about to be elected, and you know he's going to close the border down, and that means all those unaccompanied minors and children who don't have their family with them or parents, it's possible that General Kelly isn't too excited because his shelters won't be filled up with unaccompanied migrant children, which means those giant contracts could go away. You know, you think The Atlantic would just do a tiny bit of digging? If your business is built on open borders, maybe you have a slight bias against Trump becoming president.
And an LA Times editorial boss has resigned after billionaire owner scraps their endorsement of Kamala Harris. In this YouTube short, Tulsi Gabbard explains to Sean Ryan how Gavin Newsom is taking away parental rights in California. Bear in mind, this is the agenda for the whole country if you vote blue.
That Gavin Newsom just signed into law, man. The bill that he just signed into law, taking away parents' rights in the most fundamental way to make it so that the state of California gets to make the decision to allow your child to undergo irreversible mutation surgery in the name of quote-unquote gender-affirming care.
Things like that are a big reason why people feel hopeless.
Yeah.
And it's not necessarily how do we hold the politicians accountable. For somebody that doesn't believe that, like myself, who I'm conservative, I have views on both sides of the aisle, but I will never, ever agree with the gender stuff with kids. When I hear that, it registers in my brain that every single person that voted blue is for that.
It's not true.
What is more sacred than,
I agree,
than little kids?
Yeah.
Did you see this?
Dear Kamala Harris, let's get one thing crystal clear. The vast majority of American men have no issue with electing a female president. Our issue lies solely with you. You were second in charge of California for 13 years.
As California's Attorney General, Harris promoted enforcement of a law that allowed prosecutors to seek jail time for parents of truant kids.
As a prosecutor in law enforcement, I have a huge stick. So I decided I was going to start prosecuting parents for truancy.
I thought that was crazy. I was like, how can you lock parents up?
If you don't go to school, Kamala's going to put you and me in jail. Yes, we achieved a intended effect.
I opened the door and I see at least 7 or 8 cops that wanted to arrest me. As a matter of fact, they did.
And frankly, you know the prosecutors in my office who volunteered to do this? My homicide prosecutors, my gang prosecutors. And they went over there and I said, when you go over there, look really mean.
She had me arrested and prosecuted because my handicapped daughter was sick in the hospital and had missed some days of school.
I learned that with the swipe of my pen, I could charge someone with the lowest level offense. That person could be arrested. They could lose time from work and their family.
Megyn Kelly just took a flamethrower to child gender affirming care. I'll let her do the talking. The only input I have on this one is that Megyn Kelly is the hottest woman alive over 50 years old. I don't care what you say.
Almost equally important, maybe as important, is the what we're doing to our children with this trans insanity. I mean, this is almost my single issue. We are chopping off the healthy body parts of young children without, 100% we are doing that.
Well, we are definitely doing that.
Without any inquisition.
That's what it is. So
into
I don't know what
happening.
The ooing is about.
I don't either. Pay attention, because I'm about to give you a truth bomb. Kids who are suffering from bullying or who have been sexually assaulted or who are going through normal puberty and feel uncomfortable in their bodies will say to their parents, I'm not sure, maybe I'm gender confused. They will send them into a psychiatrist or psychologist who are told by our organizations, the American Psychiatry Association, and all the others that run their licensing, you must affirm. Affirm is the only standard. And so the child gets told, you're right, you are secretly a boy, or vice versa. And the child gets put on puberty blockers into cross-sex hormones, which sterilize a child and deprive the child of any chance of sexual pleasure for the rest of his or her life. We're talking about 9, 10, 11-year-olds who cannot give informed consent. Then they have body parts chopped off by a medical establishment and by parents who mean well but believe in these doctors, and they shouldn't. And when they inevitably get past the awkwardness of puberty or what have you, and they want to turn around and detransition, those who love bomb them on Reddit saying, come on in, the water's fine, abandon them. They are depressed. They have changed their bodies forever in a way that is irreversible. And
this next one is a couple days old, but it's still relevant. Election day is in less than a week, and it's looking like a tight race.
All right, I went back through the time machine to see where were the past two races at this point in the campaign. Look, Harris in the average poll right now is up by 1, well within the margin of error. You go back 4 years ago, Joe Biden was well ahead of Donald Trump in the national popular vote polls. He was up by 9. Even Hillary Clinton was up by 6 points. So now Donald Trump's in a position he really hasn't been before at this point in the campaign, where he could truly compete, and we can truly say that the popular vote at this point is way too close to call. Of course, this is only going back 8 years. I wanted to jump even further back in my time machine to get an understanding. Hey, I haven't heard about a Republican potentially winning the popular vote in a while. And it turns out a Republican winning the popular vote, it hasn't happened since 2004 in George W. Bush defeating John Kerry. And that's only the one time that it has happened. In fact, you have to go all the way back to 1988 to find another one, when it was George W. Bush's father, George H.W. Bush, winning the popular vote over Michael Dukakis. So the fact that the polls right now are so close, John, the fact that Donald Trump has a legitimate shot of winning the popular vote is something I think a lot of folks, including in my line of work, really didn't think could possibly happen when Donald Trump was running last time around. He could make history, not just for Donald Trump, for a Republican candidate as well.
Now, there are some reasons for this, and I think Democrats' heads are all exploding out there watching this right now. There are some reasons for this, which you're going to explain, but also begin to raise the possibility that we could see the reverse. We could.
In this post by What If Altus, Rudyard Litch says, quote, "I hate it when the second and third world regimes appeal to first world values in their propaganda we all know they don't believe. Then gullible Westerners fall for it and actually think China and Russia are better countries than America. The propaganda is so transparent, I find it hilarious." And imagine going to an Ivy League school and still ending up as a pathetic loser like this guy.
Go Trump. Exactly. What do you think about that?
Go Trump?
Yeah.
You're stupid.
Okay.
What do you play? You're like attack?
No, don't.
Look
talk.
At this shit.
No, thanks.
Okay. Look at this shit. Please, I play lacrosse. I skateboard.
Bye.
Okay.
So now you're talking shit to me.
No.
I went to Stanford. How old are you?
How old are you?
30, 40.
You're too old.
Nice.
I make $500,000 a year. What do you make?
Why are you here?
That's why? Like, because I'm here as a public sidewalk bitch.
Okay.
Get used
okay.
to it. You play this. I skateboard. I was at lacrosse. Are you attack or forward? Who cares? You guys suck.
Bye. Okay. Have a
bye.
Nice
bye. Go to Stanford. Go to Stanford.
No, we don't
want to. Hold on. Only 100 people apply for Stanford. Only 4 get in.
Nice.
Not you guys.
I don't know.
Still don't believe me a civil war might break out? Well, election interference is happening all over the damn place! Will there be another J6 this time committed by the Smurf party if Trump actually wins?
Person joins us outside the Lancaster County government building with more on how this happened and what it means for voters as well. So in the last week, the Lancaster County commissioners, they tell us that they received 2 large batches of voter registration applications. And as the election workers were going through them, they started to realize something was a little bit off. So they're now investigating election fraud. But as they're doing that investigation, the county commissioners say this should actually make Lancaster voters even more secure in the integrity of their election.
Lancaster County detectives began investigating the voter registration applications and immediately found applications that were indeed fraudulent.
2,500 voter registration applicants being investigated for fraud in Lancaster County.
Immediately, some of these applications were in the same handwriting, and quite frankly, the signatures were almost identical as well. So that right there, you know, is a tip off.
Other indicators of fraud included inaccuracies with addresses or even fake personal identification on the form as well. Now, the Lancaster County DA says not all the applications contain inaccurate information.
But the individuals listed on the applications informed detectives that they did not request the form, they did not complete the form, and verified that the signature on the form was not theirs.
The DA wouldn't go into detail about any suspects, but she says they have reason to believe this is part of a large-scale canvassing operation dating back to June.
Thus far, of the investigations that we have completed, we have determined that 60% have been fraudulent.
She says there are 2 other counties that have received similar applications. She wouldn't name them, but says her office is working with them.
And people should feel confident, really, that we're catching this stuff.
Pennsylvania House Republican leader Brian Cutler released a statement about the election fraud investigation, saying, "This investigation serves as a stark reminder of the lengths criminals are willing to go to try and impact our electoral process."
And this one, I purposely put towards the later segment of the video because it will straight get my channel nuked to even say this word otherwise. MSNBC called Trump supporters Nazis, and everyone is talking about it. This seriously might be one of the biggest journalistic blunders of all time, and I'm predicting right now, every news network that is participating in this rhetoric is going to end up paying massive fines for defamation.
MSNBC is facing intense criticism for its coverage of Donald Trump's rally at Madison Square Garden. The network controversially aired footage from a Nazi rally in the same venue back in 1939. The anchor noted that Trump's rally took place in that same place, calling it particularly chilling. This comparison sparked outrage online, with critics accusing MSNBC of incitement. Conservative voices on social media defended the rally's diversity, with one user stating, "Yesterday's Trump rally was filled with Americans from every walk of life. Among those attending was a Holocaust survivor, Jerry Wartsky, who had endorsed Trump just last week, calling him a mensch and rejecting Vice President Kamala Harris's recent claim that Trump is a fascist. Even Elon Musk, who spoke at the rally, lashed out at MSNBC, labeling them the scum of the earth. The backlash points to a larger sentiment that despite Democrats calling for positivity and unity, MSNBC's portrayal of Trump's supporters as akin to Nazis is perceived as divisive. Republican commentator Colin Rugg echoed these sentiments, saying, "You don't hate the media enough?" while also mentioning Worski's presence at the rally. In the end, this MSNBC segment has only fueled accusations of media bias, with Trump supporters arguing that the liberal media's portrayal crossed the line.
This one will be no shocker. Kamala is refusing to denounce the Nazi comparison in comments. I'm telling you, she doesn't want to win. She never wanted to be president. No one could accidentally have PR this bad. I'm sorry, but I refuse to believe it.
I talked with Governor Walz yesterday. Okay. He compared Trump's rally on Sunday to that of one of the Nazi rallies in the 30s at Madison Square Gardens. Do you compare that? Do you find that a similar comparison?
Listen, this election is in 7 days, and I think the American people have a very clear choice. And on the one hand, you have Donald Trump, who is constantly fanning the flames of division and hate, who is trying to have the American people point their fingers at each other, or my leadership, which is founded on a lived and experience that the vast majority of us have more in common than what separates us.
In this next segment, News Nation explains how Trendyaragua's foothold in America is rapidly growing.
Growing fears and warnings at the southern border. Officials say members of the Venezuelan Trendyaragua gang are able to enter the U.S. largely because the government cannot track criminal records in Venezuela, making it easier for them to blend in with other migrants who are crossing. But the gang's presence has been felt far beyond the state of Texas, with ties to violent crimes like murder and drug and human trafficking nationwide. So let's bring in News Nation border correspondent Allie Bradley, who is live in Del Rio, Texas. And Allie, members of this gang have been confirmed in many other areas in the country.
Yeah, Nicole, it's actually the fastest growing transnational criminal organization, and it's gaining a foothold here in the United States to the tune of more than 32% of their presence is already being felt there in the U.S. So let's show you this map. This is the breakdown of where we know that this Venezuelan gang, Trendyaragua, is present. According to arrest reports, crimes from robbery to murder have been committed by these gang members in at least 15 states and Washington, D.C. So the Border Patrol Union, though, says it's even more. They're saying they're present in nearly half of the nation and says, unfortunately, they're finding out that the gang status is present after these individuals commit crimes because they come in without criminal history in the United States, and countries like Venezuela don't give us access to those criminal databases. Take a listen to what Paul Perez had to say.
Well over a million Venezuelans have been released into this country on parole or for NTAs. They are not going to show up for their hearings. The ones that we've apprehended are the ones that we've actually tied to TDA are the ones that have been apprehended for committing crimes. So there are many more out there. They're operating in almost half of the United States that we know of right now. Wherever there's going to be Venezuelans, we're going to find TDA members because they're hiding, and we have no way of vetting them because Venezuela doesn't cooperate in that way.
And you know, it's scary here too, Nicole, because Paul and other agents I talked to say that these Venezuelan gang members are actually coming in with these big groups, these family groups, kind of using them as a Trojan horse in order to get into the United States. So for some perspective on just who these guys are, Representative Tony Gonzalez, who represents much of Texas's southern border, says that this gang, Trendyaragua, makes MS-13 look like babies. Trendyaragua is a prison gang that started back in 2014 in Venezuela. Nicole.
So, Allie, how are border communities preparing or responding to all of this?
Yeah, it's prepare for just about anything, right? Texas, when it comes to what the Lone Star State is doing, Governor Greg Abbott has already designated Trendyaragua as a terrorist organization and has actually demanded that Vice President Kamala Harris do the same, designate them as a terrorist group. So when it comes to those preparations that they're making here in the state of Texas, despite the efforts under Governor Abbott's Operation Lone Star, people are still coming in. So looking at your screen right now, that is very recent video out of Eagle Pass, just outside of Shelby Park, where a group of nearly 200 had crossed into the United States illegally. So what they're dealing with right now is Texas military has actually been using pepper balls to work and deter these large groups at the river's edge. Despite the traffic, though, Texas says it is remaining at the ready for anything. Take a listen.
It's a success. And we're, you know, our troopers are ready. Our soldiers are ready. We have been in a proactive, you know, phase. You know, even when crossings were down in this area, over 87%, we're still in a proactive phase, meaning that we're not going to stop what we're doing. We're not going to stop, you know, reinforcing areas that we see that are vulnerable to potential legal crossings. And we're going to continue that moving forward.
And it's that proactive stance that Texas has maintained, because we were actually there when the governor was making their forward operating base. That's going to hold up to 2,300 soldiers. That opened to about 300 soldiers back in May. We were there for that construction of that base. Now, when it comes to what Governor Abbott is doing here, Nicole, really interesting, because he just reissued a disaster proclamation when it comes to the southern border on Friday. He added some additional counties there, but just really doubling down that the crisis is still happening at the southern border and Texas is still at the front lines of that fight. Nicole.
All right, Allie Bradley, live for us there in Del Rio. Thank you.
And here, Douglas McGregor exposes how illegal migrants receive more government benefits than American citizens do.
Average American earns about $31,000 a year. That's it. The average American pays about $16,600 a year. Keep in mind that a person who works all his life and then tries to draw on Social Security can expect a monthly payment of probably $1,400, if they're lucky, $1,400. We hand every alleged asylum seeker, illegal migrant, pouring into the border in Texas or wherever else, we hand them when they get there $2,200. And we put them on that $2,200 diet from there on out per month. Yet somebody who works all his life, retires and draws Social Security, gets $1,400. The Afghans who were hanging on to the planes in Kabul trying to come to the United States, when they arrived, they received $2,200 a month. Now, if you can make sense out of this, please try, because I don't think most Americans can make sense out of this at all.
And a truly unpopular opinion on Reddit. I am voting for Trump/Republican for the first time, and I am not a villain or a bad person. Let's get into it. So here's what the post said. I am very capable of making my own points and standing my own values, but I will just let Dr. Phil explain exactly how I feel and why I have chosen to switch to the right after 15 years of voting Democrat. I'll link the Dr. Phil video below. What he said was about bullying and shaming those with opposing views is why the left seems entirely hateful, and basically the opposite of what I grew up to believe progressiveness meant. Edit. I'll take a look at the comments on this post, and you will get all the evidence that you need. All the majority of you did was attack Dr. Phil and Trump's character and completely avoided the actual premise of the post. This is not about Harris or Trump, it is about left voters versus right. Argue all you want about Trump, but that is not the point I am making. I am simply saying the people that are voting Democrat will attack you and your character simply because of opposing views. Within the last 24 hours, I've been called a pedophile, Nazi, transphobic, racist, and sexist. None ever in my life has ever called me any of these things, but the moment I go on the internet and express an unpopular political opinion, the first reaction from most people is character insults and accusations with no backing whatsoever. A lot of you just proved the exact reason for this post. Edit 2. I have read most comments and arguments, and while there were a few people on the left and people in the middle that had substantial opinions, majority of you based comments on assumptions and pointed your anger towards Trump or the Republican Party as a whole in the past or present, yet the only people that seem to recognize the purpose of this post seem to be right-leaning. I will be straight up. This was a social experiment just to prove my point that the left will do character assassination and assume the worst of every person that does not agree with them. Thank you all for participating. And here's some comments from that same post. One commenter says, someone must have flipped the switch on Reddit recently, because the pro-Kamala slash Trump is a fascist vibe has gone from like a level 10 to level 100 recently. The reply on that says, the election is a week away, the propaganda machines are starting the final push. And another person replies and says, Tony Hinchcliffe being a Nazi was not on my bingo card. And in a few minutes, I'm going to get into this story. Hundreds of ballots burned. And also, just an honorable mention, did you hear Biden had to stand behind a guy wearing an unhinged MAGA hat while he went to vote? Even if the Democrats win this time around, I don't even think Democrat voters will believe it was legitimate. This really does feel like a complete landslide is coming in a few days.
Here is actually a harvested U-Rod. We actually do throw it. So this is what it looks like when it comes out. Do not touch.
What more I need to show you for you to realize you're about to accidentally vote for a 60-year-old woman with the intelligence of an autistic toddler? Are you ready for your neighbors to go completely fucking insane in a few days? I'm warning you, it's coming, no matter who wins.
I said nobody wants you around here.
You're on camera.
Okay, that's fine. I'm just telling you, we don't really care about having you down here. That's all I'm saying.
Good for you. Free country.
It is a free country, so I guess as soon as you leave and take your stuff, it'll be gone again, okay?
Black guy, but SUV.
What did you say?
Platinum.
What did you say?
Shooting shit.
What did you say?
I'm right here.
What?
I'm right here. Sequoia.
What are you doing?
380 ISY.
What are you doing?
I'm standing here.
No, I'm saying, what are you doing looking at my license plate?
So that if you do anything wrong, I've got you on camera.
What do you mean do anything wrong?
I've had signs stolen from me.
Oh, really?
Yeah, really.
That's too bad. I'm sorry that they're doing that with your stuff, man. I guess it means
I doubt that you are.
No,
380 1SY, Virginia. Black man, about 6 feet, 190.
Oh, wow. What is your goal with this, man?
My goal with this is so that if someone tries to steal my signs, I have a description of them in their vehicle, and then I report them to the police, and then they get arrested, and then they get a criminal record. So that's what's gonna happen to you if you interfere.
I'm not interfering with your shit.
You're stopped in a travel lane.
Man, that's a bike lane that I use every single day because this is where I live. You know, like, it hurts my heart.
You're the one that approached me.
I did approach you because
yeah,
every time
you did.
I drive by you, it incenses me. So,
well, that's your problem.
It is. It's not my problem. It's my prerogative to stop and say, hey, man, you're not welcome here. So that's what I did.
So many people come by and say, they're so glad that I'm out here.
That's fine, man.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, I'm not.
I understand. You're still blocking. You're still blocking traffic.
Okay, that's fine.
It is.
But yeah, yes. What the fuck?
3801SV. Yeah, I need to have a record of your license plate. So if you do something wrong.
What do you mean, do something wrong? It's a free country, correct?
You know what I'm talking about.
No, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't give a fuck about taking your little shitty fucking signs, man. What am I going to do with that shit?
I have
There's
no idea.
There's enough people who aren't going to stop by who are going to just wait for your ass to leave and rip it
so
out.
So, you're not welcome here.
I am welcome here. I fucking live here, my guy.
You're not welcome here.
Is this do you own this fucking
So,
property?
Now you're harassing me.
Oh my God.
So, are you stalking me or harassing?
I just had a shitty day.
So, that's one. If you come by again and harass me again, that's stalking. North Carolina law.
Okay,
yeah.
Fine. I'm from Virginia. I don't fucking know about.
Well, you said you lived here.
What? Trump. You do what?
You said you lived here.
I do.
Okay, so back off, move away, or so I
now
call
you. Now you are. Are you fucking serious, dude?
I am. Virginia plates 3801SV. Harassing. Now he's turning around.
And here we have a sweet, empathetic, and respectful black lady versus transphobia.
I'm leaving the spa that I've been coming to for like 8 years. And I know I look upset, and it's because I am. this spa?
It's called Island Spa and Sauna. It's in Edison, New Jersey.
I've been coming here for 8 years. This is like my place of refuge. It's where I come to relax after like a crazy week or after a very stressful incident, or where I come to just clear my mind, you know, like, and just, yeah. In this spa, there's like a Korean bathhouse. In this bathhouse, there's like spa, hot tubs, a cold tub showers, a place where you would get body scrubs, and saunas and stuff. My typical routine is to come in, soak in the hot tub, get a massage, come back, soak in the hot tub, go have lunch. Then maybe like I might do a body scrub, I might not. After lunch, I might soak in the hot tub, get in the sauna, and then leave. That's my typical routine. And in this Korean bathhouse, everyone is completely naked. So there's a side for men that you can enter through the men's locker room, and they have their own side with their own hot tubs and stuff. And there's a woman's side, which you can enter through our locker room, and it's only women in there. So today I come in, I soak, I go get my massage, I get ready to go back into the like bathhouse for women. And I walk in and I see a penis and chest hair and a low haircut. So I freak out and I run out. And I go to the people that work there. I'm like, oh my goodness, I think somebody came into the wrong side or something. There's a man in there. Now, there's also all women working in there. So they all look at me in discomfort. And you can tell they're embarrassed. And they're just like, it's a trans woman. So now I'm in shock. Sorry. I'm in shock because this person saw me completely naked, you know, without my consent. And I saw... I don't even know if I should call it a trans woman because it looked like a straight up man. I'm talking chest hair, a low cut, a very big penis, like, and was older in age. So he clearly like had to be in his 40s. And you can tell the spa workers are like torn because you could tell they're uncomfortable. And he's walking around, you know, penis swinging. And they're like, well, if someone identifies as a trans person, we legally can't make them leave. So I'm crying at this point. I'm crying at this point because at that point, I've been coming here for 8 years and this is one of my safe spaces, like where I go to like unwind and everything. And it's like just that quick, my safe space just became unsafe. And I was just, I almost felt like, I don't know, I'm trying to wrap my head around my feelings. I kind of feel like something very private to me was taken from me without my consent. And when I say something very private, meaning my body, like I shouldn't have to be in spaces where men have full access to me naked without my consent and vice versa. So I'm crying and the manager, you could tell, is very apologetic. They feel bad because they're like, legally, New Jersey law, there's nothing we could do. So they're like, we'll comp your admission fee and we'll comp your food, but would just charge you for your massage. So I immediately get dressed and I leave, and I'm at the front desk like, and I'm embarrassed that I'm crying because I'm like, this shouldn't feel this like intrusive, but like I felt like, I don't know, I felt embarrassed because we're kind of like conditioned to feel like, oh, everything's transphobic, like me even feeling this way is transphobic. But I was very, very uncomfortable, like, and I just feel like I have the right to feel that way. So I don't know if I have like $500 with the gift cards here. I come here, like I said, I've been coming here consistently for 8 years. I come here, I do my yoga when they have yoga sessions, like, so it's just, I don't know. Help me to wrap my head around this, guys. Like, am I bugging right now?
While we're on that tangent, let's lighten up the mood for a second.
Yeah, this is all for me. Yeah. Nah, like, I'm being dead serious.
Being dead serious about what?
This is my ID, please.
You can take your money?
I know he gotta be joking right now. Okay, search at what? A&G?
You really like to put money, but your whole character might not be.
Period.
No, y'all, period. No, I sure both.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Nah, it's Abe G.
Honey, that's like me saying I look like Bobby.
I mean, like, no, like, I mean.
And here's Common Core math explained by a child who uses it. Hello? The government is de-evolving us.
When I was in school, Lucas, all we did, out here, I carry the one, and I'll go 1 + 4 = 5 + 1 = 6. That's my answer.
Love how you showed how it's actually done.
How it's actually done, okay.
These are the tens, and that's the one.
Can you?
4 times is 20, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Okay, that's...
And then 7 ones, one more 10.
Okay.
10, 20, 30, 40, 50. This one should be the red, so it goes up 50, and then it counts one more up, so it will make 63.
And Steve Bannon, the man who named Cambridge Analytica, just got out of prison. Not gonna lie, even though I agree with it this time, it is kind of suspicious how on point this campaign has been for the Republican side. And the timing of it with Steve Bannon's release. I've always believed the company still exists and just changed its name. I bet all politicians use it now too. But who the fuck knows? I have to report on it later in another rabbit hole. A good starting point though, if you don't know what I'm fucking talking about right now, is watch the documentary The Great Hack, which is all about this whole story. I'll link the trailer below in the description for you. And Rebel News visited New York and people are turning out for Trump.
Back in line with it moving forward for already a couple of hours, the amount of people here willing to wait so many hours just to see the former and likely future president is wild. It's insane. In New York City, in what is known as a true blue state.
Looking at New York City right now, the bluest city in the nation by some accounts, and seeing all of this love, all of this peace, all of these red MAGA hats, I think Trump's got it.
Are you a New Yorker?
Diehard New Yorker, born and raised.
And has the energy changed in New York regarding Trump?
We're starting to see it. We're starting to see it. But you still got weak-minded, spineless fools out there that don't see it. Which the mainstream media keeps on lying and lying and lying.
I think more people are coming out and they're actually waking up and they're not scared to say that they're Trump supporters, because that's the problem. The media wants the people to feel like they can't give their voice and let their voice be heard and let people know what they really feel and represent.
2 years ago, you'd get beat up.
I honestly never thought I'd see this, considering, in case you forgot, New York is the state trying to put him in prison. Clearly, a large demographic of the people of New York do not agree with this heinousness. And I mentioned in my last video that North Korea is sending troops to Ukraine to fight for Russia. Yeah, it happened. And they sent 10,000 soldiers.
Tensions are rising in Europe as the U.S. confirms 10,000 North Korean troops are in Russia and could be used to bolster Russian forces near Ukraine in the coming weeks. NATO Chief Mark Rutte says the move is a significant escalation of the conflict. CBS News Pentagon reporter and producer Ellie Watson is at the Pentagon, where they are closely monitoring the situation. Ellie, thousands of North Korean troops have been inching closer to Ukraine. Where are those North Korean troops headed? And will they be on the front lines helping Russia fight Ukraine?
Yeah, U.S. officials told us that a small number of those North Korean troops are already in the Kursk region, with the expectation that several of those 10,000 will continue to move in that direction over the next several weeks. Kursk, if you remember, is in Russia and where Ukraine launched a surprise offensive in early August with one goal to try and draw Russian forces away from eastern Ukraine. That hasn't really happened in any meaningful way. Russia has continued to claw back territory in Kursk, as well as maintain pressure in eastern Ukraine, but at a significant cost. September 2024, while it was maintaining both of those fronts, was the highest month of Russian casualties over the course of the entire war. Officials here see these North Korean movements as Putin potentially trying to solve the problem of Kursk without suffering even higher Russian casualties and without calling a mass mobilization, which would be very unpopular within Russia.
President Biden is calling the growing tensions very dangerous, Ellie. The Pentagon says that the U.S. is not limiting the use of American weapons, though. Does that mean the U.S. could be supplying Ukrainians with more weapons in the coming days?
The supply chain for this war is very complicated. President Biden has already committed that he will continue to send out those drawdown packages. So those packages of weapons we see about every 2 weeks, of ammunition, of air defense interceptors to Ukraine, no matter if there are North Korean soldiers fighting. But where it gets complicated is the surprising friendships Russia has had to make. North Korea is the first to send troops. North Korea has already provided ammunition containers to Russia, but Iran has also provided missiles and drones to Russia, and China has provided technological support so that Russia can keep building weapons. So the Biden administration likes to call, is calling, the North Korean movements an act of desperation by Putin, which is true, but Putin continues to find a way to supply his war of attrition.
All right, Ellie Watson reporting for us this morning. Thank you, Ellie.
World War III is happening now if America doesn't de-escalate it immediately. Literally, everything is already put into formation. China has occupied the South China Sea and surrounded Taiwan in the past few weeks. Check my previous video. The United States has sent its whole Navy to the Middle East and South Pacific to support Israel and fight China and or Russia. It's about to go down. This isn't a game anymore. We need to de-escalate. I'd show you the news of Israel striking Iran. Yeah, that just happened, by the way. I also mentioned that it was going to happen in my last video. Anyway, I got a bajillion clips to go through in this episode still, so forgive me, but I'm not gonna show it. They bombed the shit out of them, though. Look it up. And Ted Cruz exposes Judge Mustafa Taher Kasubra as a Marxist. I'm trying to speedrun through these last clips, so I'll just let you listen to Ted talk on this one.
Judge Kasubai, I think your fellow nominees owe you a debt of gratitude because many Biden nominees have been extreme, but your record is so far out of the mainstream that you have attracted virtually all of the questions. I was particularly intrigued by your statement to Senator Blackburn that you said you are not, in fact, a Marxist. And then you said, and I wrote it down, I have not praised Marxist ideas. Now, as you know, in law, there is the fact of evidence. And so let's go to something you wrote, an article that is entitled Centralized Property Theory. In which you wrote, it begins, it's on the front page of your law school newspaper. You write, quote, intimate knowing, the lover's kiss, familiar and ever exciting, passionate transcendence, beyond the physical exhilaration lies a burning light in our limbs, our hearts, floating, flying, falling in every direction, amorphous and wonderful, time stretching, space curving, exquisitely explosive eros. And yet I timidly tremble every time. Now, somehow this is about property, which is not immediately evident as to why, but later in the article you write, you say, property is not simply a relationship between an owner and an object of ownership. Property is primarily a complex relationship between people and secondarily regards the objects people exploit. Historically, three paradigms have dominated European notions of property. Locke appealed to the notion that labor points to who has the right to exploit property. Bentham relied on utility to dictate who has rights based on how the property is exploited. And Marx was plainly disgusted with the alienation that property imposed and its establishment of an us and them and haves not. Each theory alone denies important components of human experience. Among them are the ability to work, the need for personal privacy and boundaries, and uniquely diverse desires which spin us all in differing life directions. However, the process towards integrating all three may provide a framework for relationships that enhances each unique self. The aspiration towards intimate knowing, the intimate knowing of oneself and others, is a creative struggle towards redefining property. What the hell does that mean?
Senator, when I was preparing and reviewing my materials and, for this hearing and for the process, I also have to admit that that writing was far from clear or articulate, and And the poetry was definitely not good. Now,
told you we'd get into this. It's going down. Hundreds of ballots damaged in ballot box fires. I had a whole bunch of clips about this, but we don't have time. Anyway, here it is. People are about to go fucking crazy over this one.
Well, early voting by Dropbox is under increased scrutiny in Washington State. This is kind of a chilling story here and worth keeping an eye on. One county in that state now hiring additional workers to monitor all of the Dropbox locations in that area 24/7, around the clock. All of this after a fire, as you see there, was set inside of a Dropbox. This was in Vancouver, Washington, Washington State, as well as another one in nearby Portland, Oregon. Hundreds of ballots were damaged in the Vancouver location, three others in the Portland Dropbox area.
Authorities say the two fires are connected. They're on the lookout for a Volvo that was seen pulling up to the Portland Dropbox shortly before that fire broke out. Disinformation Desk correspondent Liz Landers joins us live from our DC newsroom with the search for that suspect. Liz, good morning.
Yeah, good morning, guys. As you saw there, alarming video of ballots on fire in two separate locations that authorities do believe are linked. These happened in Vancouver, Washington, where hundreds of ballots, as you mentioned, were destroyed at that location. The election officials in that state are now urging anybody who dropped their ballot in that ballot box over the weekend to please contact them immediately to request a new ballot to make sure that their voices are heard in that ballot and their vote is counted. Fortunately, that other incident in Portland, Oregon, there were only three ballots that were destroyed there. Those election officials reaching out to those affected voters in that state. As you mentioned, the authorities are reviewing surveillance footage to find who exactly committed this crime. We know that local and state authorities are on this. And then yesterday, the FBI said in a statement to Scripps News that they are aiding in this investigation. It is, of course, a crime to set a ballot drop box on fire. The FBI says that they are actively investigating those two incidents that occurred in the early morning hours. And they are urging anyone who has any information about this to please come forward.
And the media is cycling a story right now about the Gaza war's potential impact at the polls.
One potential hurdle for Vice President Harris is reluctance among some Arab American voters, especially in Michigan, to support her due to the Biden administration's support for Israel in the war in Gaza. Ed O'Keefe is in Ann Arbor, Michigan, where he spoke to voters who previously told him they would not support President Biden when he was the likely nominee.
Speaking of which, Andy Ngo shared this post about the arsonists who burned the ballot box in Portland. It says, breaking, I can exclusively report that handwritten message declaring all drop boxes will burn, free Gaza, was discovered in Clark County, Washington and Portland, Oregon. Through the use of incendiary devices, the footage of ballots being reduced to ashes went viral online and across national media. However, without evidence, Democrats and leftists have been blaming the arson attacks on MAGA, which is literally true, and I'll get into it on live stream later if I have time. Until this news came out, everyone on Reddit was claiming Trump supporters were lighting the ballot boxes on fire, and there's been zero evidence of that so far. Trust me, I actually follow the news cycles. And check out these whack jobs being interviewed on their way inside of the Kamala rally in Detroit.
And J.D. Vance even said if he had his way, if you had four kids, you and your wife would have six votes.
Oh. Me personally, I'm part of the LGBTQ plus community, so that's really important to me. And obviously, I really don't think that Trump is going to protect people who are part of the LGBT community, especially those who are trans.
Did he actually say that? I don't know.
He didn't exactly say that.
Corporations have been gouging. Yeah. Corporations made huge raises in prices of things.
Okay.
And Kamala has a plan for getting that backed up so that they can't gouge you in times of trouble.
Well, what is that plan, you know?
What is that plan? I don't know that plan exactly.
Yeah, and these guys sure look like a bunch of Nazis, don't they? And I don't have enough time left to roll a clip about this one, but you can look it up. Philly man indicted for threatening a Pennsylvania poll worker is a Democrat, and poll worker was a Trump supporter. Next, David DePepe, who assaulted Paul Pelosi, is going to prison for life. Next. YouTube and Google are accused of censoring the Trump Rogan episode. Next! Voter intimidation is happening. Roll the clip.
1 week from tomorrow, and more than 46 million Americans have cast a ballot so far. Here in Texas, more than 5 million people have voted early.
But tonight, we're looking into new reports of alleged voter intimidation across the country. A bulletin was just issued about this, and Teresa Woodard is live in the newsroom to tell us more.
Yeah, Chris, the Department of Homeland Security issued that bulletin today, warning that domestic extremists are posting about threats of violence toward election officials and infrastructure. The motive to prevent or retaliate against perceived fraud. That is all according to ABC News Tonight. We knew emotions would run high in the final days before the election, but with a week to go now, things are escalating even here in Texas. First to San Marcos. That's where police say two flyers appeared last week, then more this weekend, taped to Kamala Harris campaign signs. The flyer says, "You have been identified and are now in our national database of Harris supporters." It goes on to say that once Trump is elected, you are guaranteed to be audited. They are signed the Grand Dragon of the Trump Clan. Police have two of these flyers as evidence, and they are examining them for prints.
The charge is voter coercion, and it's under the same statute in the penal code as coercion of a public servant. So it's like intimidating some type of official, or in this case, the state rolled in voters as well. That's a Class A misdemeanor, so this is on the same level as an assault would be of an individual.
Now let's talk about what happened in San Antonio. The Bexar County Sheriff has charged a voter who allegedly punched a poll worker. The sheriff there says the worker told the man to remove his pro-Trump ball cap when he was voting at a local library, and the voter ended up hitting him. Now, the most stunning escalation happened in the states of Oregon and Washington today. Police say somebody set fire to ballot boxes where voters can return their ballots. This is a process several states have been using for years. Tonight, police say someone used an incendiary device to start both of those fires, and they do believe the cases are connected. Now, it is against federal and state law to intimidate, threaten, or harass a voter, or to tamper with voting equipment. We have an entire write-up about your rights as a voter. You can find it on the homepage of WFAA.com.
And a dude got kicked off CNN for throwing identical rhetoric back at them. They completely lost their shit about it. And believe me, they lost credibility for it too. And they lost votes for Kamala. Roll the clip.
Want to be called Nazis? Stop doing.
You're called an anti-Semite more than anyone else at this table.
Yeah.
And people will sit there and no, by me. I never called you an anti-Semite. Okay. I mean, I'm not sitting here saying
I'm a supporter of the Palestinians. I'm used to it.
It's fine. I hope your beeper doesn't go off. The thing is,
that you just say I should die.
You should not.
No.
Did you just say I should be killed?
No, I did not say that. No, I did not say that.
Hold on. Did your guest just say I should be killed?
Hold
on. On live TV.
I said I hope you're.
Let me just stop.
You said you hope my beeper doesn't go off.
You said I'm a big supporter
of. Of the Palestinians.
Guys, Hamas?
Guys, let
I said Palestinian.
Are you?
Am I what? No, of course I'm not.
Palestinians are not.
Then I apologize.
Are you a racist, violent person inciting violence against
Ryan,
me?
Ryan, that's disgusting.
That is
completely.
Then I apologize.
Good job, CNN. Let's have first block say the Muslim guy should be blown up.
I apologize.
On TV.
Don't say
then wow. I apologize. You literally.
Don't say it. I thought you said Hamas.
Him.
You didn't think
no.
I said Hamas.
Yes,
I said I supported Palestinian rights.
Yes, I did.
Why? Because when you hear Palestinian.
What's funny is Rudy Giuliani said this yesterday, so you're a great guest to be here to defend Rudy Giuliani.
Give me one second. Give me one second. And so at this point.
This is what we're in. No, this is America
this.
In 2024.
Here's what I will say.
Forget
here's
the racism.
That's right.
It's I should
that's
die.
Right. I didn't
that's,
say that. You
said, what does beeper mean? Don't give me a fake
I did not
ignorance.
Say you should die.
Why did you say
guys,
with my beeper?
So what did you mean?
What did you mean by the beeper? What did you mean by the beeper? No, you didn't. You said, I hope your beeper doesn't go off.
Ryan, stop talking.
At least have the guts to support your racist comment.
Hang on. I'm so sorry. Gotta bring it back.
We're back here, and before we get started, I want to just address what happened in the last segment. First, I want to apologize to Mehdi Hasan for what was said at this table. It was completely unacceptable. When we get this discussion started, you'll see that Ryan is not at the table.
There is a line that was crossed there, and it's not acceptable to me. It's not acceptable to us at this network. We want discussion. We want people who disagree with each other to talk to each other. But when you cross the line of a complete lack of civility, that is not going to happen here on this show. It's a heated time. We're in the middle of a political season. We are 8 days from a presidential election. But we can have conversations.
This smooth brain wants to sue Trump for making her sad.
Guys, how do you feel about a lot of us, blue voters, filing, I don't know if it would be a civil suit or a class action suit against Donald Trump and his minions for the stress and the anxiety and the effects on our mental health and physical health and well-being, along with the suffering of our relationships that Donald Trump has caused us.
Biden called you garbage. Roll the clip.
Donald Trump has no character. He doesn't give a damn about the Latino community. He's a failed businessman. He only cares about the billionaire friends he has and accumulated wealth for those at the top. So he says immigrants are poisoning the blood of our country. Give me a break. He wants to do away with the birthright citizenship. Who the hell has said that in the last 100 years? And just the other day, a speaker at his rally called Puerto Rico a floating island of garbage. Well, let me tell you something. I don't know the Puerto Rican that I know, or Puerto Rico where I'm in my home state of Delaware. They're good, decent, honorable people. The only garbage I see floating out there is his supporters. His demonization of Latinos is unconscionable, and it's un-American. It's totally contrary to everything we've done, everything we've been.
And here's a New York Post article about the ballot arson. Pause to read or join my Telegram group. Oops, Planned Parenthood is accidentally a meme. And ugly women don't want to date Trump guys. Whew. And this kid, Ginger Ninja, is fucking hilarious. I'm definitely gonna keep featuring him.
Let me quickly show you what we shouldn't normalize. Okay, I'm in position.
And the Supreme Court ruled that Virginia can purge illegal voters because, duh. And Patrick Bat David is calling out what I'm calling the podcast wars. And fucking finally, as usual, Charlie Kirk is an absolute Chad.
Why are more far-right hate groups such as the Proud Boys and stuff like that going for Trump specifically?
Why is Iran for Kamala Harris? I don't know what the question is.
Nazis like Trump, okay.
Do you know who Richard Spencer is? Do you remember that name? The white supremacist. You know he just endorsed Kamala Harris and voted for Kamala Harris? David Duke, you know that name?
No, I do not.
Yeah, David Duke, former leader of the KKK, also endorsed Kamala Harris.
Interesting.
So, but what do you think of Antifa?
Well, are you for fascism? Because that's what Antifa is.
Hold on, let me get this straight.
Because Antifa is anti-fascist.
Well, that's their name, but in practice, they hunt people down and batter them and assault them.
Do they?
Yes, like Andy Ngo and like myself and many others that have been hunted down by Antifa in the past.
I mean, there are plenty of like crazy people out there on both sides. I just find it funny how more of those groups are going for him.
But again, you know they're, what I mean? They're not, because look around you. This is your average Trump supporter is what you're surrounded by. Decent, amazing people that want a better country. You have one side that is trying to troll with whatever ridiculous stuff and interrupt me. You have another side that here wait patiently and ask questions. Which side wants civil dialogue and free speech? Why don't they come up to the front of the line and have a discussion? What are they afraid of?
I don't know. Maybe they don't like being in front of crowds. That's to each their own. I mean.
Yep, but maybe you should ask them. Thank you for your time.
I'm an undecided voter. I consider myself a moderate. I am the son of Costa Rican immigrants, and I also identify as a member of the LGBT community. Because of this, I oftentimes, in a way, feel forced to lean left. Could you please explain why under a Trump presidency would be more beneficial to me than a Harris presidency? I also have my mail-in ballot right here. So.
Wow, he's taunting me with that. Show the audience.
Yeah.
That's his ballot right there. Give it up for him. When you go and vote, don't even think about Donald Trump or Kamala Harris. Instead, when you vote, you're actually voting for 5,000 people that are going to run your government, that are going to run all the different agencies. So Donald Trump is assembling a once-in-a-generation bipartisan unity team of people that are gonna run the government, including Democrats, independents, and centrists. For example, Bobby Kennedy, the first Kennedy ever to endorse a Republican who ran for the presidency as a Democrat. And he endorsed Donald Trump because he believes Donald Trump would be best on issues he cares about. Tulsi Gabbard has now endorsed Donald Trump. So Donald Trump has two former Democrat presidential candidates that have endorsed him. So I would encourage you, when you go and vote, say, wow, the guy that has two former Democrat candidates together are going to represent you. And I can understand, because of the identifications you listed, you might be thrown to the left. I'm here to tell you that there's a place for you in our movement, and we'd love to earn your vote for Donald Trump today.
I won't say who I'm voting for, but when I decide, just in case, can I have a hat?
You can have a hat.
The end. Ah! Actually, fuck you, this isn't the end.
It was the next day, brothers, and I had truly done my best morning and afternoon to play it their way and sit like a horror show cooperative malchick in the chair of torture while they flashed nasty bits of ultra-violence on the screen. Though not on the soundtrack, my brothers, the only sound being music. Then I noticed, in all my pain and sickness, what music it was.
You, me, 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 me. We.
Are you ready to karaoke?
I am a champion, and you're gonna hear me roar. You're gonna hear me roar.
What you do?
Or burgers? One, two, three. Burgers. Oh, what? Oh, that's too long.
90% of emojis are useless.
Oh, I strongly disapprove.
I see reasons to use them.
Are you going to run for president?
This is the perfect show for me to finally answer.
Wow.
Time for the rabbit hole! It's time for today's rabbit hole. Today, we are talking about that weird thing that you do that's been really annoying me. Whatever it is, stop fucking doing it.
You probably have quite a few opinions about what's going on in the news cycle right now. But it's important to remember one thing. You're wrong. Here's why. To start, you're completely missing the point, and everything you think is actually at odds with reality when you look at the data. In fact, you're nowhere close to being accurate. It's simple to understand when you stop for a second and actually look at the issues. Once you open your eyes, you'll see that you're wrong about each and every one of them. Wrong, 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 wrong. But what about this other thing I heard? No. If the past is any indication of the future, not only is there no chance that you'll ever be right, all signs suggest you will never even come close once in your lifetime. The only way you'll ever be right is to repeat everything I say, word for word, to every single person you know. Until then, you're wrong.
So, what are we gonna talk about then today? Again, today? So, what are we going to talk about today then, Wolf? Today, we are going to talk about assisted sewer slides. Chronic pain, depression, the heaviness of life. Any of these things ringing a bell? Well, lucky for you, there's an option you might not have thought about. In Canada, assisting people onto the metaphorical slide to the sewer has become one of the leading causes of not being alive, surpassing even unliving from undriving cars and getting sick from expiring from pneumonia. And it's not just people who are terminally ill that this is being offered to. It's now being offered to people who have no physical issues, as in, they are just sad, and these fucking quacks are like, hello human, we represent a slippery slope, step down this sewer slide, quack. This is an excerpt from a debate, which I just linked at the time of me writing this on my Telegram, in the conspiracies only subcategory. From the National Library of Medicine. This debate piece is by a renowned doctor, and he makes a whole bunch of points, but I'm going to first read from one category titled Slippery Slope. And bear in mind, this is old, and every single thing described is currently happening in Canada. Okay, here we go. By the way, I edited everything so that it doesn't break the stupid YouTube rules. I love censorship. Freedom of speech sucks, and I would never do it. All hail Google. The slippery slope argument, if your name is Ethan, I'm sorry. One of the issues brought up in the debate over physician-assisted sewering slides is the slippery slope argument. If physician-assisted sewering slide is made legal, then other things will follow, with the final end being the legalizing of euthanasia for anyone, for any reason, or no reason. The experience of other countries shows that this is not theoretical. The Netherlands is an example of the slippery slope on which legalizing physician-assisted sewer slide puts us in the 1980s. The Dutch government stopped prosecuting physicians who committed voluntary euthanasia on their patients. Jackson 2013 931-932. Patel and Rashevsky 2015 32-33. By the 1990s, over 50% of acts of euthanasia were no longer voluntary. This is according to the 1991 Remmelink report, a study on euthanasia requested by the Dutch government and conducted by the Dutch committee to study the medical practice concerning euthanasia. euthanasia.com 2014, Patients' Rights Council 2013, Vandermass et al. 1991. In 2001, euthanasia was made legal, and in 2004, it was decided that children also could be euthanized. According to Wesley Smith, in a Weekly Standard article in 2004, in the Netherlands, Groningen University Hospital has decided its doctors will euthanize children under the age of 12. If doctors believe their suffering is intolerable or if they have an incurable illness, the hospital then developed the Groningen Protocol to decide who should die, Smith comments. It took the Dutch almost 30 years for their medical practices to fall to the point that Dutch doctors are able to engage in the kind of euthanasia activities that got some German doctors hanged after Nuremberg. For those who object to this assertion by claiming that German doctors unalived disabled babies during World War II without consent of parents, so too do many Dutch doctors. Approximately 21% of the infant euthanasia deaths occurred without request or consent of parents. Smith, 2004. Euthanasia in the Netherlands went from illegal but not prosecuted to legal to including children, and it is not stopping there. Schradenburg, 2013. In 2011, when this article was written, remember, it's way worse now. Radio Netherlands reported that, quote, the Dutch Physicians Association, KNMG, says unbearable and lasting suffering should not be the only criteria physicians consider when a patient requests to be euthanized. The association published a new set of guidelines, which says a combination of social factors and diseases and ailments. Bruh, straight up, this is Margaret Sanger rhetoric. First they came for the babies, now they're coming for children. A combination of social factors that are not terminal may also qualify as unbearable and lasting suffering under the Euthanasia Act. These social factors include decline in other areas of life such as financial resources, social network, and social skills. RNW 2011. So, a person with non-life-threatening health problems but who is a poor or lonely can request to be euthanized. In another example of the slippery slope to which physician-assisted sewer slide leads, in 2002, Belgium legalized euthanization for competent adults and emancipated minors. In February of 2014, Belgium took the next step. Belgium legalized euthanasia by lethal injection for children. Young children will be allowed to end their lives with the help of a doctor in the world's most radical extension of an euthanasia law. Young children will be allowed to end their lives with the help of doctors in the world's most radical extension of an euthanasia law. Under the law, there is no age limit to minors who can seek a lethal injection. And under the law, parents must agree with the decision. Patients' Rights Council 2013B. Some say that the U.S. state laws concerning physician-assisted sewering slides are very restrictive, and so there is no chance of erosion such as has happened in the Netherlands or Belgium. Intelligence Squared 2014B34. Yet, if there is no moral philosophical basis for PAS laws in the common good, then there is no telling how far changes to PAS laws will go in the future, and no stopping the changes. And the next category is... the pain can be alleviated argument. In medicine, we talk much these days about a good unaliving. Not necessarily one that is completely free of suffering, but a stopping to live process in which we are attendant to pain and symptom management, optimize clear decision making, and affirm the whole person in as dignified a manner as possible. Importantly, this can often be effectively accomplished through incorporation of palliative care services. Palliative care is a healing act adjusted to the good possible even in the face of the realities of an incurable illness. Cure may be futile, but care is never futile. Pellegrino, 2001. With appropriate utilization of palliative care, far fewer patients would be driven by fear to request that physicians actively end their lives via PAS/E. Proponents of assisted sewer slide, O-Reno and euthanasia, posit the scenario of uncontrollable pain as a straw man for advancing their cause. Such proponents apparently view not being alive as the ultimate analgesic. In fact, in medical practice today, pain relief is almost always possible given modern therapeutics in analgesia and the medical specialty of pain management. Since pain can be alleviated, there is no basis to assert a need for PAS because of intractable pain. This may explain in part why many requests for PAS are no longer related to or initiated because of intolerable pain, but because of fear of such intolerable pain. Further, closely related to a patient's fear of intolerable pain, and sometimes associated with a patient's fear of being abandoned, Coyle 2004. Is a patient's request for PAS because of not wanting to burden others? This too poses a curious contradiction, for on the one hand, there is not wanting to be a burden on a loved one, and on the other hand, a fear of being alone and abandoned. Such a contradiction, once considered and coupled with the fact that pain can be addressed successfully through optimal palliative care implementation, enhances the power of this argument against PAS/E. That's physician-assisted sewer sliding in euthanasia, by the way. The Oregon law was enacted on the basis of intolerable pain. No one should be forced to endure pain that is uncontrollable and unendurable. Most of us can sympathize with that. But the law is not restricted to pain, and it is not pain that is the top reason people choose physician-assisted sewer sliding in Oregon. the state's Stop Living with Dignity Act annual report. Wow, that sounds so bad when you say it like that. The Stop Living with Dignity Act annual Anunnaki report for 2014 shows that the top reason patients opt for physician-assisted sewer sliding is, quote, losing autonomy. Oregon Public Health Division 2015-5. Concern about pain was not even the second or third reason. Above it were, quote, less able to engage in activities making life enjoyable, and, quote, loss of dignity. It was ranked 6th out of 7 above only financial concerns and included not only inadequate pain control, but also concern about it. These patients were not necessarily in uncontrollable pain themselves. However, they were concerned about it, as are we. But even that concern did not rank high on their list of reasons that they wanted to commit sewer slide. Even if the line drawn is unbearable pain, how can that be restricted to only physical pain? Who can judge that mental anguish is not unbearable pain? Or that economic distress or anything else that causes anguish is not unbearable pain? Are you beginning to understand how fucked up this logic is yet? Okay, we got one more category from this debate that I'm going to cover. By the way, these doctors who posited these arguments I'm reading, yeah, they won the debate, and it's published in the National Library of Medicine. Look it up. Link on my Telegram. This was on the front page of Google when I Googled assisted sewer slide. Okay, here we go. Duh! Physician integrity and patient trust argument. When a patient asks a physician to assist in unaliving him or herself, not only is there disrespect shown to the physician's integrity, but a contradiction is created. Asking a physician to participate in PAS undermines the principled ethic and integrity of the physician, whose noble profession is defined as one of compassionate service of the patient who is vulnerable. Wounded, sick, alone, alienated, or afraid, and undermines the integrity or wholesomeness of the patient who him or herself is in desperate need of trying to achieve. To ask and expect a physician to participate in the destructive act of sewer slide violates both personal and professional integrity of the physician and leaves both the patient and the physician at risk for moral confusion about what is good, true, and beautiful about the human person. The threat of euthanasia posed by legalizing PAS also undermines trust between physician and patient. Both euthanasia and physician-assisted sewer slide would undermine the medical profession by eroding the trust of patients in their physicians as caregivers. If doctors were permitted to engage in practices that harm their patients, then patients would never know if their doctors were truly acting in their best interests. Austriaco, 2011-148. Will your doctors unalive you if he or she thinks you are too ill or in too much pain or unconscious? The oath of Hippocrates has guided physicians for 2,400 years. The oath states, I will apply dietetic measures for the benefit of the sick according to my ability and judgment. I will keep them from harm and injustice. I will neither give a unalively drug to anyone who asked for it, nor will I make a suggestion to this effect. Similarly, I will not give to a woman an abortive remedy. Tyson, 2001. Even with all the advances in medicine over the last 100 to 200 years, the public perception is still that the Hippocratic Oath is an important indicator that the patient, in his or her vulnerabilities, can put trust in the physician. Letterer, 1999-102. Euthanasia by healthcare professionals undermines that trust. Lack of trust is not just something that may or may not happen if euthanasia is legalized. It is happening in countries that have legalized euthanasia. Ostriaco points out that many Dutch patients, before they will check themselves in the hospitals, insist on writing contracts, assuring that they will not be unalived without their explicit consent. Ostriaco, 2011, 148. As stated earlier, in the 1980s, the Dutch government stopped prosecuting physicians who committed voluntary euthanasia on their patients. By the 1990s, over 50% of acts of euthanasia were no longer voluntary. This has had a deteriorous... This has had a deleterious effect on the relationship of patients to healthcare professionals. An article in 2011 in The Telegraph, a newspaper in the UK, stated that elderly people in the Netherlands are so fearful of being unalived by doctors that they carry cards saying that they do not want euthanasia. Beckford, 2011. The Dutch elderly do not trust their own doctors. Trust is not the only issue concerning the integrity of medicine. PAS also calls into question the very ends of medicine to cure and to care. Christopher Saliga, a nurse, explains that one can rightly say that in Oregon, the balance has shifted such that respect for autonomy currently has greater weight among the principles hanging in the balance than it had prior to the legalization of assisted sewer slide. As a result, the contradictory patient outcomes of life and death via continued care or willful sewer slide, respectively, are considered equally valid. Saliga, 2005-22-23. Medicine and the medical profession traditionally aimed at curing and healing. Assisting in a sewer slide is neither cure nor healing. It pits the medical profession against itself. Curing and caring versus stopping life. So there you have it. They won the debate, so I don't have to. Like I said, if you want to read the whole thing, look it up on my Telegram. This episode was so long and exhausting to produce. Stay cursed. I'm out. Bang! Whoopsie. Are they home?
Thank you very much.
Yes, Queen.